you know, I did Lolo, I shot it fall of 2014, and did post-production, came out last year in France, you know, in also in the fall, like a year later, which is usually kind of the timing. And I wanted to do a broader French comedy, but in a sense broader, what I meant is I wanted visually for it to be, you know, no too much camera movement. I wanted something kind of like pretty image and kind of pretty, kind of almost tricking people into this kind of look of it. Look, the package is very mainstream, you know, visually. And but like sometimes the content is not always completely like typical mainstream film. There's a little bit of, you know, stuff in it that's not completely, you know, but it kind of like I kind of sold, you know, it kind of worked as a main film in France, you know, as a mainstream film in France. So it came out and did quite well. So it was good. I like, you know, I like doing more indie films, more personal films, and then more mainstream was also quite a lot of fun for me.
What is it like to do everything? And I ask that quite sincerely because each of the jobs conflicts with each of the others.
Yeah, it's not necessarily, you know, it's very different. I really believe like writing and directing can be very different, and acting is different, composing music is different. You know, just producing as well, the more like, you know, aspect of, you know, putting films together, which sometimes I'm part of in smaller films and stuff. And especially my films, I was involved with almost all of them in the production side. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of, and what I'm learning as years go by is to actually delegate. Because the truth is, I don't just do, you know, I bring t-shirts on set that I want people to wear, I bring props I like, that I find in flea markets, I go further than what, you know, I'm credited for, and then it goes a little crazy. So, you know, what I'm learning over the years is to delegate, so actually I can, you know, it's okay to let go of a little bit of stuff, you know, you can't do everything all the time, you know.
When you write and then when you direct, mm-hmm. Are they both on set at the same time, or do you lose the writer when you start
always
directing?
I always lose the writer. And actually it happens to me that, you know, when I see that something doesn't work, even if I was attached to it as a writer, it goes, you know. Whatever serves the film and the purpose of the film, like really everything else doesn't matter, you know. And then when I'm acting, I'm acting, and then when I go into the editing room, I also let go of, I know that's gonna sound weird to say that, since I'm doing everything, you would think my ego is like crazy, but actually I let go of the ego, of the acting ego, and, you know, if there's a scene where, you know, I really like myself, but it doesn't serve the film, or, you know, or somehow the scene doesn't work, even though I like my performance, for example, and as a, the ego of the actress would be like keeping it in the film, I end up cutting it, because what's first comes first is, you know, I become the director again, and, you know, I kind of let go of all the other stuff, so.
You studied filmmaking in New York, right?
Mm-hmm. At NYU Film School, yeah.
Did you also study in France at all?
No, I didn't. I studied only in the U.S. I really enjoyed NYU. Yeah, it was great. It was great. And, you know, I had a wonderful teacher that, you know, was very nice and gave me a really good grade. I don't know if I really deserved it, but it made me, I was very insecure, you know, and it gave me a bit of confidence, and that was very nice. You know, confidence is everything, at least enough so that you're not scared to do things. Because I think being insecure makes you stop yourself from doing a lot of things. Actually, there's research done on that. Like, if you tell someone, you know, because people have this myth that you can't learn an instrument after a certain age and stuff, but if you tell someone, no, you can, they do it.
What is your background in music?
My background is classical music. I was trained classically to do music. I play clarinet for almost 15 years. I quit. I didn't know I had asthma, so I couldn't breathe. So it was not a good instrument that I picked somehow. I love the sound of it, and I wasn't a bad clarinet player, I just didn't like it. It hurts. It hurts the lips, and it hurts your your body playing clarinet. So I then went into other instruments like piano. I did a bit of violin. I did flute. I did and then guitar, and then I studied a lot of music solfège, which is what's the word, music theory.
Solfège.
Yeah. And so I was quite good at music. Like my background was more musical than anything else. So I have a good sense of orchestras and, you know, everything, which is in a way, you know, I did my own music. It was not very good in 2 days in New York. I really did last minute. I couldn't find a composer. No, we had no more money. So I just did it myself. It was silly almost to do it, but I did it, you know.
Well, that's the power of believing, because it came out well.
Exactly. You know, it's like, I can do it. You know, I can do it. So I did it. It's really not great. But this time on Lolo, I had a wonderful young composer. But the good thing about, you know, he was talking about that yesterday, Mathieu Lamboulet, is that, I can really communicate with musicians, because I know, you know, if I want more of, you know, if I want to change a violin part for a hobo or a flute or something, I know what it sounds like and I know what I want. And so it helps to have a musical background, I think, you know. Also, weirdly enough, music affects me a lot when I see movies. I often find that there's too much music in films. Not all films, but some films, too much. And when I notice music too much, it's usually not good. That means there's too much of it and it's not, it bothers me. When music bothers me, and it bothers me often, it's a weird thing, because I hear music and I analyze it. Like, I can't listen to a score in a movie without, you know, analyzing it. So sometimes it disturbs me. It annoys me when there's too much of it, and I feel like it's using it to kind of emotionally put me somewhere that the film itself would not put me. I know it's part of filmmaking, but sometimes I find that it's used in a way that's kind of tricking people into emotions, which in the end, it ends up backlashing for me. It ends up annoying me, actually, sometimes when people manipulate me with music, you know. I have movies that I really would have liked so much better if the music was different. There's so many movies, it's crazy. And there's some films, I believe the music made the films. I believe Hitchcock without, Bernard Herrmann was not exactly Hitchcock, you know? It really is a very special music, you know? Or Godard without Delarue, you know? It's so amazing.
You worked with Godard very early in your career.
Yeah.
Can I ask you about that?
Yeah, of course. I remember Godard, actually. That was a period where I was, you know, kind of observing, I don't know, or maybe it just... Yeah, I loved working with him. He's extremely smart. It's like working with a scientist. It's actually more like working like a scientist or a philosopher than working with a director. His approach to cinema is not like a usual kind of filmmaker. It's more like a scientist.
And in what way?
Not that I know many scientists, but I mean, I am friends with a few scientists, and Godard reminds me more of a scientist than a... His way of approaching cinema is much more kind of like trying to discover something, trying to have a eureka, you know, trying to kind of create something new and discover things, and kind of, it's almost like he's doing research instead of really, you know, like kind of, yeah, it's like a research he's doing, you know, a study of some kind. And you know, I love his films, you know. And
what was he like to you as a young actress?
He was very nice. He was very, very nice, very kind. I was young and quite insecure. I mean, very insecure. And actually, he's a very kind person to insecure people, because he knows that he has that quality that he wants to help insecure, but people that... He's the opposite with people that are full of themselves. So he can be really cruel and mean sometimes, but only to people that are very, that are almost too self-secure. Then he goes a little funny with them, but with people that are insecure, he's very sweet.
Tell me about the future. What do you have in mind? Are you working with some of the same actors in France, America?
No, my next film is I think it's going to be a British film.
British?
It looks like it.
Is this the first?
Yeah. But it's actually going to be French, a lot of French money, mostly French money and UK. And it's a drama. Because I like making comedies, I like being crazy and goofy, I like being the clown. But I also have a side of me that's like a little darker, you know? So I like to go back and forth. And I haven't been able to express my dark side very much. Sadly, because it's good to express your dark side. Probably better, healthier than being the clown.
Well, you have a little dark side in your comedy.
Yeah, I would say Lolo is not all fluffy and cute, you know, the film. So, yeah, I like the dark, you know. I think dark is funny. I think dark is a great way to approach, you know, to mix dark with comedy. I think it works really well.
Here's Julie Delpy as Violette in a shot from her new film. And thank you, Julie, for this conversation about your work and your film Lolo that was just screened at the Rendezvous with French Cinema at the Film Society of Lincoln Center. And as always, thanks for watching.